America, the land of wealth, freedom, adventure, endless resources, countless dreams, and the American Indian. European settlers arrived on its shores seeking freedom from persecution and a fresh start. But along with their ambitions, they brought diseases and philosophy to justify the shameless exploitation of America's resources and its proud indigenous peoples. These foreigners called it manifest destiny. Nowhere in American history is the legacy and exploitation of genocide of the American Indian more prevalent than the tragic history of the Sioux Indians of the American Plains. These names are familiar: Sitting Bull, Crazy Horse, Little Bighorn, General Custer, Wounded Knee, Pine Ridge, Leonard Peltier, the American Indian Movement, Russell Means, Black Elk, Red Cloud, fixtures in the American consciousness of the Native American resistance. And although the American Indian population has dwindled from 40 million before the Europeans arrived to less than 1 million today, the American Indian continue to preserve in a hostile environment that they still consider this land home, a place the settlers named America, where they, on their own land, are treated like prisoners of war. In 1851, the U.S. government signed the first Treaty of Fort Laramie that specifically defined the geographic borders of the Sioux. Pursuant to that treaty, this was deemed Sioux land, a sovereign nation in the Great Plains. In exchange, white settlers were granted safe passage on the Oregon Trail as long as the river flows and the eagle flies. Red Cloud, warrior, soon to be chief, the only man to ever beat the U.S. Army on their own land. He took down General Custer at the Battle of Little Bighorn.
This war was over the fact that the 1868 Treaty of Fort Laramie was broken,
which guaranteed the Sioux their natural-born rights to hunt and provide for themselves, as they'd done in the Powder River Country. More importantly, this treaty exempted the sacred Black Hills from white settlement forever. No white man would ever set foot in them Black Hills again. This treaty was signed with the hopes that the whites, with their endless flock of settlement and bold weapons of mass destruction, would not annihilate his people. But he soon learned, in the eyes of these foreigners, those treaties weren't worth the paper they were written on.
Unopened eyes, no consequence. The door's been closed since he's walked in. The fight's been raging so many days. He'll greet you with a cross and a sickle as he helps you in.
Over 150 years later, another Sioux, a descendant of the great Red Cloud himself, trained for combat by the U.S. Army for service in Vietnam, studying the laws of Native Americans and U.S. government, dedicated to the traditions of the Oglala Lakota, businessman, biker, novelist, artist, warrior, spawned an idea to reclaim the land and water and dignity of the Lakota that was promised to his great-great-granddaddy. His name is Big Jim Red Cloud. The idea was simple and would require the white man to find himself wandering on that same land that they stole. It was to appeal to the sentiment of those first European invaders. A promise of adventure and gold. The great American frontier.
Inside your own soul lives a man that you're supposed to be. Not the one that this world has molded you into. Not the one that you saw in a book and think, I want to be like that man. But there's a man that God made in you. And you people don't become that man until they go to a point where they can't have a choice but to be that man. And that's what the Hoka Hey was about.
My name is Makpialuta, Red Cloud, of the great Sioux Nation. I first saw this challenge in a dream, a humblake, a vision. I saw 10,000 horses riding beside me into battle, their hooves pounding the earth. And telling my father, Burdell Red Cloud, he explained Ashukamilawakam, a modern translation of the holy metal horse, which translates to Harley Davidson to me.
Jim is an idea man, and when he came up with the idea of doing this long distance endurance ride, it stuck.
Our way of life, you have to suffer to a point to where the suffering is so bad that when you turn to Tukashla, to God, then you can hear him speak. This was the thing, taking people that far down, taking these warriors far enough down to where they could hear the voice of Tukashla. When they realized that Memphis to that next place was almost 3,000 miles, they were alone. It freaked some people out so bad they quit right on the spot. You think you're in a motorcycle race, but we're on a journey and we needed your help. We needed strong people to do it. So I did trick you. I did lie to you. Yes, I did. Before long, there'll be no more Lakotas. But we don't have water, we don't have food, and we are dying. We're not strong enough to do it ourselves, so I employed you.
Yeah, I used you. I used you to beat us.
Come on, Jim.
You didn't use anybody.
Come on.
I've used you
to get water for my people.
You want to get water for
this man. For that, I thank you.
A dirty little secret. It's kept hidden. The reservation is so remote that it's not something that people go out of their way to visit when they're on holiday in the Black Hills in South Dakota.
I was born in Pine Ridge, South Dakota.
Pine Ridge is very secluded.
Three families living in one house.
No running water. We have no bathroom.
This is not a racial issue. This is a human issue. Pine Ridge and its hopelessness to produce an environment so tragic, it's a more attractive thing to die at 14 than it is to live at 14.
A lot of my friends, you know, they turn to drugs and alcohol, suicide.
Friends that I have graduated with, they've hung themselves too.
I had to get up every morning and walk next door just to take a shower. I had to get up every morning, go next door and eat because at my house, at the log cabin, there's nothing there.
Every freaking week, there's this big U.S. truck that pulls up. And it says U.S. government on the side. They hand boxes of diabetes out of the back of that truck. It's called commods.
God, they just keep us in poverty.
And you wonder why I am the way I am today.
90% of that reservation exists on commods. Because there's no jobs, no food. You have to get it from somewhere. So the government, which they were doing 130 years ago, handing bad beef out, or handing out fatty foods that kill people. The reason there's 52 years of life for the adult male on that reservation is because of that food. There were 40 million of my father's people here. The Indian people, that same 40 million people, are now, as of 2000 census, reduced to 1.8 million Indians left on this United States. So genocide is watchable. You can see it happen on a daily basis. This is not just about Pine Ridge. This is the last stand of humanity. We have to fix this thing we call hate. In 20 years, if something doesn't happen, there won't be anybody left.
All the hospitals are at a level 1 and 2. That means we have to practically be dying before they send us to Apple.
I wish I could get my people could get the medical treatment Obama gets.
Can you tell me what crime it was that Indian people have committed to punish people through 7 generations? I thought if I can get 1,000 voices to go through 33 reservations, then they would know 10,000 voices. And if those 10,000 voices could reach 100,000 voices. And the reason being is I needed 1 million voices to say, you know what? This fact that people don't have water in this country is a crime. It's a crime committed against humanity. It doesn't matter if it's Indians. It matters that it's American human beings. We're not talking about racial issues now. We're talking about humanity.
It's a Lakota tradition for every man to wander up in them woods until he has a vision.
then he must spend his life seeing that vision through. Big Jim's vision was a punishing 14,000 mile endurance challenge on a motorcycle for the largest cash prize ever paid. He was going to send these cowboys through 33 Indian reservations, including his own, Pine Ridge, South Dakota, America's dirtiest little secret. But there are some rules. These cowboys needed to sleep on the ground next to their horses. Ain't no hotels on this ride. There's also no shortcuts. You've got to ride this route. Jim wanted to get these cowboys off the freeway and onto the back roads, connecting themselves back to Mother Earth, and maybe just find themselves along the way.
One of the things that Jim wanted to identify from the beginning was whether or not there were 1,000 true warriors left in the world.
Well, Hoka Hey is, it's that last battle cry. It's that welling up that energy when you just, you scream. Hey, the Marine Corps, we yell, everybody says, hoorah.
The Hoka Hey means to me is live life to the fullest.
The literal translation is like it is a good day to die, which means that, you know, if you're not committed to something and you're not willing to die for it, then you're not really committed.
I'm not a religious guy, but I'm a very spiritual man. And I've done a lot of hard things. And kind of right when you're in the middle or you hit the peak, you think you're about finished, that's when it really comes out.
Anytime you waltz with God, sometimes the deaths don't turn out like you thought.
Are you having spirit things? I've had the spirits with me for days. They ride for a while, then they jump off and another one gets on. And it's like, me too. You know, it's just weird stuff like that happening.
Personally, I don't necessarily go to church all the time, but I'm very religious. And I tell people, I go, hey, after you do the Hoka, hey, you don't even need a Bible because you're like this with God.
I've done a lot of stuff in my life. I've climbed some mountains that were pretty tough. I've run a couple marathons. This race last year, it was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life.
To ride it would let you feel all these different emotions as you traveled across the great land.
And every day of your life, look in the mirror and look yourself in the face and say, okay. And figure out what point in your life you actually believe you are willing to die for your people. If you're willing to die for your people, then you're willing to live for them too.
Hey, it's good to see all you guys. Some last year of new riders. And I'm gonna go ahead and pull something right now out of my pocket.
Hoka Hey. If Harley Davidson is the mother of all motorcycles, that coin is her heart. Everybody in the country is chasing that medal, and you men and women now own one, but you'll pay for it.
That I will assure you. And we will thank all of you. You are the purest of the pure. The purest warriors, because you come to fight for something that you ain't even got no stake in. Water on that reservation.
First and foremost, this has to be about safety. That is our primary priority. This is not a race. Lakota people need your voice. We need for you to come from this location 10,000 plus miles and end up in Nova Scotia. I'm going to be there waiting on you, and I want to see each and every one of you there.
I want to introduce Keith Lundell, CEO of Harley-Davidson, EV, who brought us all together to honor you as you head off on this great adventure. And it's a great honor for us to be here, and you know, for Jim to give us these coins is a tremendous honor, and we do it in honor of you. So thank you very much.
You know the most precious bird that's in America and within the Native American tribe is the bald eagle.
Police will be out here to block traffic for us to get out on Country Club. At that point, you have to abide by all rules and regulations and laws.
Last year, he's gonna walk out to here at the stage and smudge his whole deal off. So we're just, because that's what we do. Whatever you do, pray to your God now. We're getting ready to do this thing.
Yahweh, oh yeah, Yahweh, Yahweh.
All of the men that are here, and you're talking to each other today and tomorrow and the next few days, maybe the last time we talk to each other, because some of us might not be here. We know how dangerous it is. We know that people get killed riding motorcycles. The bottom line is, this may be the last time you ever talk to me alive.
Have a good ride.
Oh, oh.
Thank you.
sure that we get an airship coming up
cool.
and any local medics.
Cool.
Tell him, advise him, I got to write her down unconscious with agonal respirations. Let's get him stripped and flipped.
You want the shoes off?
Yeah, I need to get his shoes off. I need to confirm that I'm getting an airship out here.
You have a motorcycle.
Hey, guy, can you hear me? Up on his own?
Yes.
Okay, Greg. Okay, just relax, okay? Hey, well. Don't touch. Just, we're gonna hold it. You got your head.
I'll move your head.
Okay, just lay still. Okay, Greg. Great. Okay, you're coming back and around. That's a good thing for us, okay? Okay. Firefighter, yeah.
Okay.
EMT. Okay, are you medic?
Yeah.
Okay.
One thing, where's your ID at? That dog
had
actually
perfectly
scoped
for
it,
all right?
Greg Schaefer.
Check it.
Okay.
Okay.
Back up here, but he was laying down with groceries.
I'll say 40 50, so he's definitely trauma.
Oh, yeah, broken.
I'm asking for airship.
Yeah, we need one quick.
So. Yeah, okay, since any of you have my cell phone, let's see if we can get an ETA on that airship.
Stopped to see what I could assist. Upon the scene, he was unconscious. Rough estimate when the bike went off, 40-foot embankment of the helmet. The helmet's crushed in the back. Back of the helmet got shattered from the crash and the rocks. He's got spinal injuries, head trauma, broken ribs, possibly collapsed lungs. He's swelling up pretty good. It's a 50-50. Not lefty. He's having a hard time breathing.
It's like where the sun was coming up, that he didn't even see the truck.
I saw it. I don't know.
Just climb right off the pump. Sorry.
Dangerous game, man.
God knows it ain't his. It sure ain't no surprise. We're living on the edge.
Ahead of us, so that causes us a little bit of problems.
Let's rock this bitch.
Stuff done and head to San Francisco.
had a 90 degree temperature change. 90.
Right. My calf got pulled off or whatever because I was running at the last checkpoint, man. So I pissed my pants probably 3 or 4 times, sat in it all day. We've been battling. We took the lead right after the chase vehicle and came up about 20 places. And just kept on it, you know. Where's Mike at? That dude's fast, man. That dude can ride, man.
San Francisco, I told Will, I said, have you ever split lanes before? And he said, in India on a moped. I go, well, it's a little different here, so just follow me. So we had to split lanes probably all the way leading up to the Bay Bridge, over the Bay Bridge. And we got into San Francisco and went across the Golden Gate Bridge.
One more for the soulmate dreamers, one more for the wicked man. One more for the peaceful protest that keeps the war in demand. But who knows if I'll see you again? But who knows if I'll see you again?
Probably not, no.
Problem with my bike, I pulled over to fix a muffler bracket, and Will pulled over and said, hey, I'll see you later, and I never saw him again, so.
Yesterday I rode, 25 hours straight. I was the first one into that checkpoint.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, some of these guys haven't slept. I don't know how they
I know. When are they gonna...
That was Frank, yeah.
Coming through San Francisco that night, it was like misty on that coast. And I'll tell you, man, that was the first night I was gonna sleep. And I parked right on the coast and I looked across the street and there was a bed and breakfast. And man, you have no idea how tempting that. I thought, man, this is bullshit. It's raining, it's cold. What the hell am I doing? I was thinking for a second, you know, just go get a room and end this misery. And that was actually the first night that I, first and only night I pulled my tent out. So I pulled the tent out, slept in that tent. I mean, it was a bad night, you know, just cold, miserable night. But when I woke up that morning, I just regrouped and I said, I'm gonna go out and kick their ass. And that's exactly what I did.
Such is the way of the world.
The whole way, you do go into a nearly a trance like state where the riding is just done by remote control.
Oh, such is the passage of time, too fast to fold. Suddenly swallowed by signs, lo and behold, gonna rise up.
Hard explain, but I just got so much out of it as a person.
I'm gonna rise up, throw down my ace in the hole.
guys.
We slept an hour and 20 minutes.
We've been up front probably five or six different times. So, I mean, really, they're chasing us. We're not chasing them.
So I caught up to him, and he goes, you want to partner up and let's ride this out.
Let's work it out good. They're going to have their hands full. Where's Will at?
He keeps asking me. He's like, what'd you do? Did you race dirt bikes? Was you a track racer? Or he's like, I used to be a cop. I didn't do nothing. He's like, that's cool. You were a cop? I said, yeah. He goes, if you meet any of my friends, you are a road racer, okay?
Okay, all right.
But do you have guys' jeans? I might have to just get a pair of jeans. I've been in these for 3 days.
Yeah, it's bad.
Yeah. And can I go ahead and put them on? Because I don't have like.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, there you go.
Sean, how you doing, sir?
All right.
Who do you think the biggest threat is out there right now?
Me.
I'm from Florida, and we have Indian reservations there, but our Indians have developed into, you know, the casino powerhouse of the country, I think. I mean, they got, you know, the Seminoles are doing extremely well with it. And I don't know how that money's distributed. It's none of my business. But obviously, it's still concerning that there are other peoples within our country that were here long before we were that are suffering the way that they are.
After reading about it, I knew it wasn't something you just jump into. A lot of people find out real quick. You don't just jump on a bike and ride 10,000 miles.
Cot set up in the warehouse. I'm going to take a nap back there. Guys, sorry. Time to roll, man.
Wow.
He stopped for probably 20 minutes and slept. Started moving again, but.
Will did?
Really? Got about 120 miles on us.
It's time to get going.
You're riding up the Alpine Highway, or not even the Alpine, you go through Wyoming or Montana, any part of this country, and you stop and you see, you know, the buffalo, and you just see the open prairie or pasture and just go through these mountains. Amazing.
You guys been riding neck and neck for a while?
More like together.
Yeah.
There's always somebody better. There's always somebody faster. But I wouldn't want to have to beat me. I always felt that I had a shot.
He's got lucky charms in his pocket. I don't get that lucky, man. I get caught behind all the traffic. I mean, if the light's gonna turn red, it's gonna turn red on me.
Seems like a real nice guy, seems like a stand-up guy, but you know, me and him got one little issue, and I'm sure we'll get it worked out eventually.
We knew on that last leg, we weren't sure what to do. We couldn't, you couldn't finish first by trying to go faster than the other rider, and you couldn't necessarily get away by managing your fuel stops, because if Frank stopped, I was going to stop. If I stopped, he was going to stop. And so he came up with the suggestion that we cross the line together. He and I were then close to each other for the rest of the route. And so he came up with the suggestion that we cross the line together.
We felt like it was probably the safest bet instead of us sitting there battling each other.
You know, when I thought about two tired men on heavy Harleys, you know, dueling.
It was getting dangerous, and this was probably the safest way to come in.
He actually gave Beth a phone call
and said, is there a problem with two people crossing the line at the same time? And Beth said that there was not. And in the next breath, she brought up to Frank that, but Frank, you've got an issue with missing the checkpoint at the chief's house. And I suggested that they discuss that amongst themselves later and that we go on and ride.
I was never told that I was ever disqualified. I never made it a secret that I didn't stop there at the chief's house.
Beth and Jim were very clear that unfortunately he'd missed that checkpoint. I think at that point I said that if necessary, I would have carried Frank across the finish line with me, and I think he would have done the same for me. There was a high degree of bonding there.
After 6 polygraph tests by the number one polygraphers in the country in New York and another piss test, the guy calls up and says, you got to pay this dude. About a week and a half ago, we transferred $500,000 to his account.
Yes, I left Homer with the assumption that, yes, I have won, you know, $250,000, and it's a lot of heartburn. Not so much towards the Hoka Hey. I mean, I got a little bit of heartburn with that because they let me ride so far, you know, after, you know, supposedly I've been disqualified, but, you know, more upset with Will for not living up to his end of the bargain. But
where are we going now?
Oh, Sturgis.
Have fun, bro.
Hey! Yeah, we chased him down. We passed all them in Yellowstone, man. Same deal.
I hit the wall about 40 minutes back.
That's why I have to take a break.
That's fine. You don't care if I go on without you?
I'll catch you. I'm worried about that.
Can I use your bathroom? My cap, where you guys all know the story.
So bad. I mean, the sun just killed it.
This is just like NASCAR. When do you change your tires? When do you fuel up? It really is.
If he needs to go on, I'll probably just holler at him to go on. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to be here for 2 hours.
Reservation or meeting any Jim's ancestors. I mean, I have my own I'd like to meet. So, and those are the ones I talk with when I'm out on the bike. Just couldn't.
I'm good, thanks.
All right.
I got everything.
Sounds good.
I'm already packed. Going to the chief's house.
I don't want to get overconfident for sure. That's about when everything starts to go bad. No, my plan is to get out of here and maybe get another hour's nap or something and just try to roll on and put some distance between me and the other guys.
Up
luck.
Thanks.
Quick call right there. Main Street surges this time of year. I better get going before it gets any later in the day and gets packed.
The 1868 treaties. The treaty is the only reason that that reservation is still intact.
Everything that has to do with the United States government is designed to colonize us. Nothing is there to reinforce our culture.
When Mr. Columbus came here, there was 40 million of my dad's people and none of my mother's people. In a period of about 400 years, that number now in 2000 was, in Shkawiates, the white nation, is now 250 million. And the Lakota, or Indian people on this continent, in the United States, went from 40 million of my father's people to 1.8 million Indians left here. You get on a boat, you come all the way across the ocean so you can pray how you want, and then you kill all the people here because they don't pray like you.
But they forgot one thing. You see, they brought over greed and money with them.
The gold rush in the Black Hills of South Dakota was influence on the non-Indian people to settle the area. And the sacred Black Hills, and they are sacred to the Lakota people, were taken over and they were pushed out.
Like the Black Hills, for instance, we can't even go up there. I mean, one can go up there, but we can't stay there, you know.
The power of our spirituality is through our language. The power of our spirituality is in the Black Hills. We have to have the Black Hills back. Going to the world court and filing genocide to try to get the Black Hills back is almost our last desperate act to keep our culture.
Genocide is watchable. You can see it happen on a daily basis.
If we keep violating our language, our sacred ways, there's going to be nothing left for the future generation.
Sometime along the night going by him, so I'm sure he's coming.
Yeah.
No, this was my only problem.
Last year. We're not gonna go there.
Hello, sir. How are you?
Well, Steve, good. Well, where are you from? Good.
Frank Kelly from South Carolina.
Oh, that's quite a ways.
Yes, sir. Long distance.
Okay, now.
There you go. It fits you good.
I heard you come, so we're getting ready here.
Oh, yes, sir. You're about to get ready to get a lot of motorcycles coming in here.
Yeah.
I'm just the first of many. Yeah.
The United States is supposed to honor us, our treaty rights. And my great-great-grandpa's the one make that treaty. That's why you're here, back in the century. I'm 93 years old,
and
I'm still working for the tribe, for the treaty rights.
Yeah,
you look around, look how many million people here in the United States, now USA.
Yes, sir.
And look where I am now. So that's why we're here. We welcome everybody.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Will you pray for him, Grandpa? Will you pray for him?
Yeah. So what, you're going through, huh?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to pray for you because today people use that stuff they're not supposed to use and they're on the road. So I'm going to pray for you where you're going. Okay, let's pray. Hope Tatra will let you. On the yoke, the yank. Oh, gosh, I want you to know. Don't care, I'll beat you now. Okay, I tell the Creator to help to watch you where you're going. I hope God, Kukashla, God, watch it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you stopped here.
Well, I'm glad I did too. And thank you for having me. Yeah. I appreciate it. So.
Okay. Watch this. Good. You bet.
I guess I'm going to get on the road and start
Louisiana
heading down.
Louisiana could just see you twitching over
yes,
there.
Yes, yes, I know Will way too well. he's coming on strong. I'm
persistent.
Sure. Dropped my bike right up here in front of that gas station last year. So everybody looked and clapped and laughed. Catch y'all later.
I did pretty good last year and that got taken from me. I went through the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation and chose not to go there.
I told him that I think he had an issue because that was the surprise checkpoint.
How you greetings.
Doing? Thank you.
Glad to see you.
Good to be here.
You gotta go say hi anyway.
I'm gonna go say hi.
Hello, Chief.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, doing good. Good. I had a lot of help getting into camp last night. You know, after I finished last year, I knew I could do better. And there was no way that I was gonna be able to hear about a second Hoka Hey and me not be part of it. I knew I could better myself. I'm a pretty competitive person, and I like to win. I like to do as good as I can, but there was more to it. It was just the whole spiritual experience, the challenge itself. August is always a tough time for me leading into September. I lost a lot of guys. Lost my little brother, 34 years old, also a fireman. When that second tower collapsed, I knew that he died. I literally felt a wave go from my feet through my body and out of my head. And I just knew that he was killed along with hundreds of other firemen and maybe thousands of people. Whenever I ride, he's with me. I'll have a picture of Michael right on my gas tank the whole time. Don't know if I'll win, but I know that anybody that comes in ahead of me is going to have to work real hard because I plan on working real, real hard. I swear to God, I'm having conversations on the motorcycle with my brother,
really,
with spirits over here. I'm talking to everybody. They were sitting right next to me. I remember saying to myself, where am I right now? I'm like, who's driving my motorcycle? I felt like I was on the back holding on to somebody. Did a nine and change. Today, since 17 hours, all on back roads. You know I can't hang out, right?
I know.
I'm in 16th place.
Pfizer!
I'm just, I wish I could bottle this adrenaline I got right now. It's sick. Whenever I win, we're throwing a party.
Well, I didn't know Greg personally. And unfortunately, I had to meet him on the circumstances that I did. I had no idea who he was till I pulled his dog tag off of him.
This man helped another individual that wrecked his motorcycle, probably saved the man's life.
My name's Kelsey.
This is Chief Oliver Red Cloud.
You bet.
How you doing?
Good. She said that he broke all of his ribs and punctured a lung. You feel bad for the guy, because I'm trying to get people to come. They don't even want to hear what I got to say. Hey, you know, I need your help. Come here. And they just, off up the trail they go. And it's like, you know, that's what's going wrong with the world today is people don't care about other people.
It's sad that people in our country have to live like that. I mean, we're supposed to be the best country in the world, and we should be able to take care of our own people. You know, you say what you want about sending foreign aid to all these other countries, we should be taking care of our own people here first. Whether it be the Indians on the reservations that are poor and don't have anything, or the inner city kids or folks that are getting piss poor educations or don't have, you know, food on their tables. Those are the people we need to be taking care of.
I'm just surprised that here's the chief, and I mean, he doesn't live in a great house. I mean, his house is in most economies would be considered, you know, really kind of on the poor level. He doesn't have a lot of amenities or anything. I mean, he lives a simple life, but he has a dirt driveway and everything. And I just think the American Indians are kind of forgotten. People just, they don't, unless you go on the reservation, you're not going to see it. You know, they are kind of forgotten people. I think it kind of gives you a wake-up call when you go through there.
First, it was just about my bucket list, you know. That was my ride to Alaska, you know. You may not live another 10 years, who knows, you know, because this was round two for me for breast cancer. This wasn't a first. I had already done this once. So it's pretty scary the second time because you think you beat it. And then it creeps up on you and, you know, I have grandkids, I have kids. I want to see them raised, you know.
One group will have the power and they'll mistreat the ones that don't have the power. And it just seems to be one of the weaknesses of human nature.
Like I said, Jim broke my heart when he told me about those people. And then I started reading about them and I started finding all this information out about, you know, I mean, going all the way back to Wounded Knee, the horrible, horrible story of Wounded Knee. It just really tugged at my heartstrings. And last year they did a benefit for me. This year I did a benefit for them. I started raising money and bringing awareness for the Lakota Sioux, because somebody needs to know. Somebody needs to know that these people are out there like that.
So the idea of Hoka Hey was to bring the unity of all cultures to bear and take a look at one place, you know, and say, hey, some of this is wrong. This is a human issue. This is not a racial issue.
My dad used to say, there ain't nothing here. There ain't nothing here but heartache. That's what he would say. So I found that out. It was true. It's hard to live here on the rest. You gotta be tough to live down here. You gotta not be into material things. You can't be into money like that, because I mean, you don't have that stuff down here every day. It's hard to find a job.
Under the conditions of the same numbers, and when you look at the numbers the government created 6 months ago, on Pine Ridge Indian Reservation alone, just Pine Ridge, our females have a 500% higher greater. We didn't create these numbers, the feds did. And then they released them. 500% greater uterine cancer rate amongst our females than any other place on earth, including Africa. We have the highest rate of teen suicide of any culture on the planet. We have infant mortality higher than Africa's. Average life of a male born and raised on the reservation never left 52 years of age. Out here in the world, 77.4. A female is 56 years of age on Pine Ridge. We have the highest rate of diabetes of any culture living today.
God, and a lot of people are dying from that hospital because they say, oh, one of my in-laws over here, she was sick. For a whole week, she kept going back. They just kept telling her, drink a lot of fluids, you'll be all right. So she goes back again, and they're like, oh, your uterus is swollen. And she looks at him, and she's like, I haven't had a uterus for 12 years. She had cancer in her, where her uterus went. So she had to go, they sent her to Rapid. They were like, oh, and they send her off to Rapid, and they find out she has a cancer ball big as a grapefruit. So they had to take it off.
We really have to put up a fight. But they all don't right. Get the best of me, I'll tell you that right now.
Hopelessness is the disease on Pine Ridge. And the symptom of that hopelessness is alcohol and drugs. One of the young boys was graduating 12th grade. Only problem was, he read at a third grade level. Third grade reading level, you can't even get a job at McDonald's. All they did was create him as a prisoner. Say, we have the highest rated teen suicide of any culture on earth. There's a place called White Clay, Nebraska. It's 1 mile from downtown Pine Ridge. They sell 3 million cans of beer out of that place every 12 months, more alcohol than any place else in the United States, to about 6,000 people.
I had a $5,000 hit, man, on me, man, from the liquor establishments in White Clay, guy.
I called him my brother, Shiloh Pierce. He died because he hung himself.
Because, you know, White Clay is just a mile away, and, you know, there's drugs coming in and out. They try to, you know, get jobs, they try to go to school, but there's people there telling them that they can't do this. You're nothing, you'll never amount to anything.
To put that temptation so close, it's just wrong.
Fusco used to say, "Don't look at me, look in me, for in me was the love of all humanity." Well, that's the same thing. Don't look at White Clay and those people there. Look in them.
Well, obviously, after going through the Pine Ridge thing, I mean, you know that we're doing this in an effort to bring recognition to their situation. But as a competitor, you know, you're seeing all these other parts of the country that aren't dilapidated at all. Oh, they're beautiful. You know, I ran into Sir Frank running through the Dragon's Tail, and I thought, this guy's going to be, you know, a good old boy, regnant type. You know, I know these kind, they're tough. They'll put themselves to the frickin' ringer. And then we come out the other end, and he's just petering out on me. What the hell? So I ran up next to him and asked him.
You all right?
Yeah, man, all right.
Hey, bro, you all right? Yeah, man, I'm good. I figured maybe he wanted to follow me for a little bit. So I take off, and next thing I know, he's gone. I talked to him later. He said, "Dude, you didn't see the guy standing there with the flag? It was a construction zone." I said, "Dude, there wasn't nothing there. What are you talking about?" He goes, "Damn, I knew it was hallucinating." And I mean, you know, he wasn't the only one.
I actually, Jesus came on my motorcycle and I think saved me at one point. He says, I don't know how to ride this thing. You're too tired to ride it." He said, "Don't do this again." And he points over here and he said, "You see that dirt over there? That's where you're going to sleep." And I took my butt right over there and I went to sleep for probably 3 hours. That was so real, it wasn't a hallucination to me. It was really, that's when it became really spiritual for me.
I saw this power plant and it looked like a transformer. It was like moving and it was going across the road. And I'm thinking, man, I need to stop and get some sleep. This is freaking weird.
I don't really know that it was on a hallucination, you know, because I felt great at the time. Right around sunset, and I look up and just remembered how I felt like it almost touched the sky. It looked and appeared that close. And I see this big, beautiful, round circle. And I'm like, oh shit, it looks like a smiley face. Two dots and a nice, you know, smile on his face. So I kind of smile back at it, and next thing I know, it turns down. I'm like, what the fucking, it just poured. It's just like the sky unloads on me. Well, I know God was with me. You know, he was probably the one smiling at me, and he gave me the frown saying, oh, sorry, but I got to do this to you.
The fatigue takes you to places that you just would never know your mind would go. I had a real problem that I guess it was like a sleepwalk, but except it was on the bike. I basically woke up in the middle of, I was on an interstate, and I didn't know where I was. That was bizarre. That frightened me. But I tried to ring my wife and I couldn't. There was times I was nearly crying in frustration. Sometimes you go to pretty dark places and you think, why am I still doing this? And then something kicks in and you don't know. I must finish. I've come this far. But I do know there is way more to our existence and the way we live and our connection with nature than what we've learned through our years of school and what's passed down from our parents. I know that for a fact now.
He said he asked a policeman up there, and by the directions he has, there was no way he should have made it here. So he's going to go back to where he knows he was right, start over with the directions, and come back one more time.
Run all the permutations. I've come in every way you can come in.
Well, you need some rest.
Yeah. You know, I've been sleeping twice as much as last year.
Really?
I'm really in good shape.
You look like.
Yeah, I'm fine. At the highest RPM you'll see me run normal ops, about 2,800. I went 330 miles on a tank.
What?
On this ride. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Big advantage. Huge advantage.
This has to go all the way to
Laconia, New Hampshire.
Laconia, yeah. That's a long one.
Oh, look at that. This is the first one I've seen.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. Yeah, there it is. There it is. And you're told to take 301 to the exit up here. But 301 doesn't exist there. And there are very clear precedent early in the directions that if you're on bypass 301 or business 301, you're not on the directions. So you got to get from here to here without using bypass or business. But I ran both.
Yeah, we saw you do.
I ran both, so I got it covered. And I've done that throughout my history with the Hoka Hey. When they've got the directions wrong, you just run every permutation, so whichever one they thought they meant, you've done it. Right now, I'm frustrated enough, I'm like, wondering if I just go home.
No.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go, I guess, from here and go to Canada.
All right.
What's up, guys?
How's it doing,
good,
man?
Sir.
I need oil, tranny, primary, and rear brake pads. Two more thousand?
I say you're supposed to be 10,000.
519, 525. I'm already at 13,000 miles. Holy shit. Do you guys have a shower in this place?
We do not. But last night was rough. It was
yeah.
Rough getting here. This is probably the toughest leg so far for me.
Hey, man, you want to use our wash bag?
That'd be awesome.
We're welcome to do that.
Oh, hell yeah.
Hey, Ricky.
Mm-hmm. Oh, feels good.
Shower on this trip.
Counting this time?
Yeah.
One. I've been chugging along. You know, I've been chugging along at right at the speed limit. I think that's relaxing.
I think it's low stress, so I think I require less sleep. I think if I were going faster, I'd require more sleep.
You are number seven.
Look at that, two of those actually.
Sure.
Right. I tried to do 2 hours of sleep and then get going again. It just wasn't happening, so I had to take another break.
Buddy, when you go on a ride like this, you better be prepared. The guys that weren't prepared, they're still in Sturgis. I rode into Mesa, and this young guy says, dude, you don't know what you're getting yourself into. I love to know where he is right now. I stop when I get too tired, dog. I will tell you that. I got three little kids at home, and I'm going to go home. So I know when to stop. Because you'll go to sleep and ride right off the side of that road, and it's over. Actually, unfortunately, I ran up on a guy yesterday that did that. He went to sleep and rode right off the road. And I don't know how he's doing. I hope he's doing good, but he didn't look good, that's for sure. They said that these guys that are doing this got to be on drugs. I'm going to tell you right now, anybody on drugs, they couldn't do this race. There's no way in hell you can do this. You'll burn out in 3 days, man.
All right, guys, see you next time.
All right, buddy.
Have a safe trip.
Thank you. Couple more trips and this thing's over. You guys better be ready to party at the party.
I was not perceived as a threat, and I was sort of under the radar and unknown for kind of the first half. I was quiet, and people started to ask online, who's this guy in the bumblebee jacket?
Dad passing away, but when you lose your son or your daughter, it's not the same.
Here they come.
Your bike, you ride up?
15 days.
How many times did you brush your teeth?
Twice.
I love this event more than anything. It's great. It's just so frustrating when you get to an intersection and none of it makes sense.
But you've been riding up here.
Yeah, we've been riding.
Yeah, I've been here all week.
We've been really here like this. You're really making me interrogate you instead of volunteering.
They went faster than I did. That's one thing I can say. So
I didn't even realize they were cutting it off at the time. So.
Wow.
When did you find out? Let's check. I thought we know
each other. An hour ago on the road.
An hour.
No, you're right. You're riding.
If we don't make it in by 9 o'clock in the morning, then there's no cash prizes. I thought they were giving out 25. I didn't know that they would had a time limit on it.
I'm on my way. I'll be happy when I do that.
This is my only income. This is the only way that I can get my family. So for me, this is livelihood, man. This ain't no punk. If I had money, I'd be doing it. You know, I'd be happier and shit going up the road and taking it easy. But that ain't the case.
We're having a great time, right?
Yeah, it's the best.
We finally got a chance to ride together, too.
Yeah. I think what's going on is, like, every single leg of the ride has had some major mess-ups, whether it's a left or it's a right or it's mileage.
You come to, some T's and there's no road signs, you know.
The deadline's 16 days, So with a couple of racks and getting the bikes worked on, we're stuck. We can't make it to Nova Scotia in time, even though we're in a top 10 position to qualify for the money. I'm not complaining. It ain't like that. It's just, it's what's right, you know, and ran out front for the first 4 days and ran into some sleep deprivation and stuff, but.
Terry told me a good story. He goes, he knows it was time to get off the bike and take a rest when he was trying to roll down the window on the motorcycle. He was like, you know what, I think it's time to get off the bike.
It's kind of good riding with him because we kind of fall asleep at the same time.
And on the road that day, we were like 22nd place at that point, and now we're in the top 10 since I hooked up with him. So, yeah. You know, it's all because of me and you riding together. I think that it's doing it. Yeah. So.
You got about five bikes behind you. The closest one is about 5 hours an hour.
One turn or he's, one piece of road, you disqualified. So is that how you're going to go back?
Or they broke the law. So even if they broke the law speeding.
Oh, really?
Everybody signed that contract. Safety comes first. That you will not voluntarily break the law and endanger the public. And everybody, I told everybody, don't, well, you don't want this fleet tracking. Goes, oh, yes, we do. If it had been up to me, we'd still be picking directions up out of a box in a field somewhere. Go to field number 18 and there's a box there. Get your shit there.
Yeah.
Horse race, you know?
Yeah, so
but if they miss a block, you're done. These guys here, if they can get there, which some of them will, anybody back here that's coming into this, each rider has a set of tracking number and a different, once those documents are in hand, then we have our footprint to make that call. Then the organization board will sit down and say, dude, 100 mile an hour is endangering the public. And a 50 mile an hour is
no matter where it was at.
No matter where it was at. You endangered the public and or your own life. It's not a race, it's an endurance challenge. Yeah, 9:34 a.m. Nova Scotia time is the last, that's the last moment you have to cross that line. On the money part. When Harley's new Harley they put up, their money they put up, even that you have to be there by that time. You have 16 days to complete it.
Chief Oliver Red Cloud, it's a long ride.
Well, I appreciate y'all hanging out here, seeing me in. This is awesome. I really appreciate it.
No trophy, no flowers, no flashbulbs, no wine. He's haunted by something he cannot define.
Announce the mighty steed Excalibur. That is her name, loaned to me by Mr. William Barclay, one of my newest and best friends. I've known this guy only for 12 months and he feels like my brother. Thank you, Will. Without your generosity, I wouldn't be here now.
The sun has gone down and the moon has come up. And long ago, somebody left with the cup. But he's striving and driving and hugging the turns and thinking of someone for whom he still burns. Cause he's going the distance. And he's going for speed.
On behalf of the Cape Breton Harley Owners Group, welcome back.
Thanks. I think it's just broken.
Glad you're here safe, man.
Oh, yeah. Banged up my hand pretty good.
What you going to do? We're going to send you to the hospital. I've called it.
Okay.
Get an X-ray now.
you.
I fell asleep three times on the bike.
Oh, no.
I've determined that Jim Red Cloud and Chief Oliver, this is their way to get back at the white men.
That's the finish. I've been sitting at the bar. Nobody told me there was a finish line. I'm glad it's over. Do I need to check in? Mike Fox, 601. That was one rough day.
I gotta tell you a story. This guy, no shit, was in the bar at the hotel and didn't know this was the finish line. You almost got him.
Someone for whom he still burns, 'cause he's going the distance, and he's going for speed. She's all alone in a pack of me, because he's racing, racing, climbing the course. He's fighting and running and running on his horse. He's racing and racing and climbing the course. He's fighting and running and running on his horse. He's going the distance.
Results from all of the polygraph tests as yet. We won't have that information until late this evening yet, and this being the day before the award ceremony.
25, 24, 23.
What we're doing right now is verifying that they followed the route according to the driving directions.
Fleet tracking was almost a necessity in this kind of event. It is the referee. And it tells you exactly what happened and what route you rode and how fast you went.
Well, they all followed the route precisely. You know, there were mistakes, but they were able to recover from them.
If I wasn't sure, I backtracked and, you know, made two separate passes, or if I had to or whatever, just to, you know, cover my ass.
Because of the fact that fleet tracking showed high rates of speed and some other inconsistencies, that what we had thought was going to be just the top five taking the polygraph test, now it ends up being all 11 of our contenders.
I think I'd be fine with them using fleet tracking data, including speeds, if they define the policy well.
My interpretation from listening is if you get a ticket, you're disqualified. So I didn't get any speeding tickets, but did I speed? There wasn't a person in this thing who didn't speed.
I think all in all, like, we'll have some disappointed people, but my biggest concern in that regard is the time frame that we gave them made it difficult to complete the route without speeding or some serious sleep deprivation. We made it exceedingly difficult.
You know what? I'm not too crazy about this polygraph thing. I really don't like it. I don't like having to come here and do this.
The test has now begun.
You know, it's new for me. And truthfully, you know, I felt like a kid back in school going to the principal's office.
Did you use any other means besides a paper map?
No.
Before taking this polygraph test, did you research on how to beat a polygraph test? Are the lights on in this room?
I guess I got my eyes closed. Yes.
You really don't know what you're supposed to do, or, you know, how you're supposed to act, and if you act a certain way, you feel like maybe you're indicating that you, you know, did do something wrong.
Before the Hoka Hey challenge, did you think about breaking the rules so you could win?
No.
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 Nobody passed, I'd be really pissed off.
The way they figured it was, if they didn't get a speeding ticket, it was okay. And then we did have people who...
No, that was also spelled out before they departed. If they read their terms and conditions, it did say that they would be disqualified for getting a speeding ticket. But the compliance section of the terms and conditions spells it out very clearly that they must obey the law, and that includes the speed.
Our understanding was we were going to come in and we were going to sit down, and they were going to tell us whether or not we passed or failed. we didn't know what it was.
Approaching or over 20 mile an hour is considered reckless.
A couple rules were broken. The only problem and difference is we can't pay you for breaking those rules.
Then you're going to disqualify the entire group.
I don't know
Will, including Will Barclay, because there's no way he could have stayed ahead of me at the pace that we were traveling without speeding.
He's next.
The real gentleman.
Will Barclay.
Down. Don't climb. What's your bike deal?
I went out to fire it up to come here, and it, you know, you turn it on, you turn the switch, and it cranks and cranks and cranks and cranks and doesn't even think about starting. So I'm not accusing anybody because I'm going to go look at it.
Yeah.
Y'all want to hear a funny story? Now everybody heard about Will said the bike won't start and know what the fuck's wrong with it.
This will happen.
Oh, this.
When we go drink.
We come back last night. Fucked up, dude.
Wow.
And we see fucking Will's bike in the parking lot. All I did was pull the fucking plugs off the fucking spark plug.
Oh, wow.
My question is he disqualified by the polygraph, by distorting the outcome?
I would say yes.
All right, that's all I need to hear.
Okay.
So, me.
I'm happy to say that the rules regarding speeding are not what I expected, and I'm happy to be disqualified by speeding.
Okay.
If I'm accused of intentionally defrauding a polygraph, I'm going to have an issue with that, and I'll have that issue publicly, but do whatever you need to do.
Okay. The average person breathes 13 to 18 times per minute, and according to the textbooks, which are produced by the United States Department of Defense Polygraph Institute, anything that's breathing under 9 times per minute is a deliberate distortion.
Yeah. You'd like to talk now, listen a little bit. I'm cutting you a lot of slack here, buddy.
Oh, you are?
Yes, sir.
Are you threatening me?
No, I'm not threatening you. I'm telling you I'm cutting you a lot of slack.
Well, going in out of what my way?
Don't go that road, please.
You don't want to go that route with me.
I'm begging you.
Okay. Now be careful who you threaten.
I'm not threatening you. And if you feel threatened, I apologize. Okay. That is not my intent. Am I clear?
I identify myself now.
Am I clear?
As a police officer. Okay.
Why are you being aggressive?
Me.
Once again.
I'm aggressive, my friend?
I agree.
You're cutting me slack and I'm aggressive?
Yes, sir.
Well, have a nice day.
Okay.
I guess Will's pissed off.
Yeah, Will's pissed off. He walked out and he said he's not coming to the ward center and he doesn't have nothing to do with this thing. So.
Well,
that's a piss poor goddamn loser in my book. I don't give a fuck how he cut.
I had to go up there and watch him down, take a check last year. I drove to fucking Sturgis and damn watched it. Didn't like it, but I watched it.
I want to bet.
We're all going to get disqualified?
What's the bet?
We're trying to get gas money.
11 for 11?
Nobody get no money.
Nobody gets no money.
You
want
to bet 100?
I'll bet 100.
Oh,
there it is.
Wow. I ain't good at betting. You found that out last night. I ain't a good gambler.
Back in Miami.
I'm all in.
Yeah. Oh, come on now. You gotta fucking. You gotta change that to another
$1 left.
Go ahead and get me and Frank and put it together.
Yeah, mate.
I'm disappointed. I've just spent $3,500 buying an airplane ticket 1 week before. I wouldn't have hopped on the plane. I'll still leave here believing I did it right.
And I don't want you to leave feeling like a failure.
I don't. I'll always be able to look in the mirror and be satisfied with what I achieved. How do you face your family and your friends and say, oh, it's just horrible?
You're hard on yourself. You know, I put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears in this, and you know, I take care of 4 women at home too. And so, I mean, I was in it for the money. Gee whiz, man, it just fucking sucks. I mean, what I did is no different than looking at a paper map. I use Google on your phone.
Well, hey, the rule, terms and conditions are pretty fucking clear.
Yeah.
You signed it. You agreed to it. They own it. They can tell you to take a flying
what.
You guys are so full of it. EB, look me in the eye when you talk to me.
But you're the, if you're going to be the enforcer of the rules, you have to abide by the rules too. You know darn well driving across the van on Highway 50. I've seen EB's cars. You can't tell me you don't do 100 miles an hour on Highway 50. You consider yourself reckless?
No.
No?
You'd be disqualified and not get any money.
Well, I'd rather not get any money and not be disqualified.
How can you have your place but not be disqualified and not get any money?
That guy threatened me and insulted me. And
I didn't threaten
you. Enough that shit.
You haven't seen a threat yet.
Jesus.
You want to see a threat?
You
I'll give you a fucking threat.
Me?
Yeah.
You two are acting like children.
He's acting like a children. This guy.
You threatened to call Harley on us.
Come on. I will call Harley on you.
Go ahead.
Nobody's going to get paid. This is ridiculous.
Wasn't the money?
There was only 200 paid riders.
So see, now it's coming back to the money again.
No. In the organization of Hoka Hey, James Redcloud, lawyer, has a whole bunch of money over
here. It's not about the money. Now you said there isn't the money.
No.
That's an incentive to disqualify everybody in this fucking room if there's not enough money. I didn't do it for the money. Okay. I own two Harley Davidson dealers.
Did you read the contract?
But do I want the money? Yeah, because I want the money to prove that this thing wasn't a fucking scam to me.
Then you're going to get money.
You're talking out both sides of your fucking mouth.
Come on, Mike.
No, it's bullshit.
Come on, Mike. That's out of order.
We put a prize. We put $500,000 of cash out here. And then we start this challenge. You call it a challenge. Structured last year. One winner. That's it. That guy gets $500,000. And the only rule was, don't get caught speeding. We paid that man off. So this year we did it. Well, let's figure out how to do business. So I went to him. One of the richest men in this country. He knows something that we don't know. We went to him and said, hey, how do we make this so that it benefits that reservation for a long time? Because there didn't been one person at home.
This just seems like doing it by stealth.
Guys, you shouldn't even waste your fucking time. They're not going to pay anybody. They could have just came out here and said, you know, if you're speeding, you're not going to win. You know, they don't want to pay. They're not going to pay. It's a scam. It's a
pleasure. I mean, I'll pay everybody right here, right now. I made a grave mistake for my people. That's a fact. Because I don't have any heroes. Will Barkley, my hero. People that function out here in your world. Because I don't live in it. I don't know how to. 57 years old, I don't know how to live with you. Because I don't get it. I don't get this shit. It's easier for me to go get my checkbook right now and pay you and walk away and never see your fucking faces again. For you to call me a scam and I'm not going to pay.
Jim,
I
want to
pay you.
Jim, that's not.
I want to fucking pay you.
Jim, you're gone. You're way off your track.
The rest of the world don't know you got 11 guys in here that go, oh man, I fucked up. I speeded. I can live with that. The problem is, where does it go when the word gets out? Not one guy got paid.
This is how the outside world is for mine. I don't want nothing to do with this. You get on that stage, you'll have your money. You'll have your money. The same shit you took my fucking country over.
Hey,
fucking money.
That's not what it's about. It's about the fact that we feel the rules were slighted and whatever like that. That's what I feel.
It wasn't about the money.
But what's transpired here is it's a loss of face because we've been disqualified. But if we can walk out of here feeling that we aren't dishonored.
You know, what can we come to that we can agree on that will help perpetuate the Hoka Hey? You know, a lot of...
Is 10,000 a piece, or do you want paid online, or how do you want paid? Because if the other option is actually stay true to what we did, no matter how the gray area is, it is qualified. I think, ain't that what you're saying?
Okay, let me ask you this then, Jim. Then how do we explain to the public why didn't Will get his 250? Why didn't...
Will is going to make a public statement that he is challenging the polygraph. He's going to go on and do his own thing.
Immediately.
Will Barclay is trained. He's a CIA contractor. He flies planes. Flies dangerous people into dangerous places. He has for a long time.
$10,000, and we'll admit that there was a critical miscommunication, and as a result of the technicality, there are no prizes except the consolation and the recognition of having finished within the time frame as the greatest riders in the world.
The most important thing is that everyone gets up on that stage this afternoon and is awarded their trophy for their finishing position, and they've got a smile on their face and shake hands and give Jim a hug and all, and we walk away. What transpires behind the scenes is only for us.
What you just said is very accountable on your behalf.
Some of the finest riders that you could ever hope to imagine are gathered here on this stage.
The riders that made it to Nova Scotia and finished across the line. So this is in no particular order. I got Sean Van Bieber, Mark Story, Frank Kelly, Michael Fox, Robert Crawford, Carl Netherland, James Hobbitson, and James Hoffman. These guys rocked, I'm telling you, rocked the house.
The idea was to be able to show the riders, not necessarily with their eyes, but with their hearts, what humans are capable of, and perhaps if they recognize that, then if they recognize that within themselves, then they can change it.
I don't want to be cool by means of saying, there's so many guys, it's very spiritual to them, you know, you'll come back as a changed man, Jimmy, you know, this, you will just be, you know, you won't even imagine what's out there that God has provided to us. That's a bunch of bullshit to me in my head, and I don't mean that meanly, and I don't mean that disrespectful to them, because it's all in our own perceptions. And me as an individual, I'm allowed to have my own perception too.
Yes, I am here to win this race this year. So I have a point to prove to myself and to everybody else that, you know, I can do it and I will do it. So.
I think Big Jim and Chief Oliver came up with this as a way to mess with white men. You know, dangle a carrot in front of her face and see what we'll do for it. But that's all in jest. I mean.
Yeah, you know, we're basically not having contact now. I've had what I thought was some inappropriate communication from him, and I've chosen to limit my communication now. I'm very happy with a lot of other aspects of my life, and I'm putting my energy elsewhere these days.
They sought adventure, a chance to prove their courage to themselves and their family and friends. A simple promise. First to enter the finish line wins. Wins gold. Wins bragging rights. But then the rules changed. They had to arrive at that finish line in Sydney, Nova Scotia before 9 in the morning. Is that a broken promise? The U.S. government turned a blind eye to settlers and gold speculators in 1875, allowing these white men to set foot on the sacred Black Hills in direct violation of the 1851 Laramie Treaty. Is that a broken promise? Rules of the Hoka Hey specifically provided that all riders must obey the state and local regulations regarding operation of a motor vehicle. This meant that they weren't supposed to speed, but admittedly, many of them did. They broke the rules. They didn't honor their agreement of the Hoka Hey challenge, and they were disqualified for that rule violation. Did Jim Red Cloud break his promise to these riders? There was an independent verification and polygraph. Riders weren't satisfied with the results that confirmed that they broke them rules. Must have been hard to have the rug pulled from under you. Must have been hard to have rules changed after such turmoil and personal sacrifice. It must be hard to be an Indian. The term Indian given starting to have some meaning now. The government made a lot of promises and then just took everything back. That's what Indian given is. Rules have been broken for gold. Lakota can attest to that fact. The Laramie Treaties of 1851 and 1868 the Indian Appropriation Act, all broken by the government that signed the treaty. And for what? Gold, timber, land, minerals, water, racism, manifest destiny, greed, ego? I'll tell you what. Our government has made a lot of promises to us that they haven't fulfilled. And if we're not careful, we might be the 21st century Indian.
Dream, baby, dream. Dream, baby, dream. Dream, baby, dream. Come on and dream, baby, dream. Come on and dream, baby, dream. Dream, baby, dream. Dream, baby, dream. Keep a fire burning. We gotta keep alive.